No, but it, I was just thinking it's funny how Sean named the bar. I mean, this hotel is 20 years old this year, and I've only been around like 6 of these years. But without forcing it, what we do has kind of stayed on theme to Sean's name for it. So Sean's name, I guess, was a good umbrella to catch a bar that was going to kind of go on to nod to these traditions in New Orleans, mm-hmm. not just voodoo,
right.
and not just Haiti, but Sicily, right. and right. Senegal, and right. Africa, and other places. But
cultures. Yeah.
But the voodoo thing works in New Orleans. You know, you don't walk around seeing evidence of voodoo really in New Orleans. It's, in some ways, it's you know, it's all in relics and the feel. And
right.
certain bits and pieces, which is kind of so walking around Rome and seeing bits and pieces, and you really do have to imagine the whole,
sure.
the whole Parthenon and everything. Mm-hmm. But the Loa are, you know, like the whole pantheon of voodoo saints. So they have different names, they have different characters, and when they're invoked, mm-hmm. there's different ways that their adherents, their followers, will please them. And you may have even heard that sometimes, you know, like rum is used in voodoo ceremonies.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I think at least one or two of those Loa, like cigars and such, they have sort of, I mean, I'm sure it can go deeper, but they're a little bit of almost cartoonish personalities. And like saints, you know, they're intercessors in some way. You know, we pray to Saint Christopher if we've lost
really
something a lot of times or lost our way. And yeah. Oh, it's Saint Anthony, isn't it?
Saint Anthony.
Yes, yeah, Saint Anthony. Oh, you lose something, right?
He's helped me out a few times.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
You lose something, you ask St. Anthony to find it for you.
Yep.
And so that, you know, that's where it gets its name in a playful way. The bar, of course, is using spirits to invoke spirits, you know, mm-hmm. uses essences. Mm-hmm. But I think we play the game in a kind of serious way because we feel that cocktails in New Orleans are really woven into the fabric here.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, people drink them all over to make social gatherings and companionship go better. It's just that in a special way in New Orleans, they're just woven thread by thread into the significant things that people do here. They are right there as like little markers of birth, death, weddings,
yeah.
business deals, everything. And so what Loa practices now, besides cocktails that try to evoke little pieces of the old New Orleans story in a playful way and almost as a sort of guide to, you know, well, these are ingredients that are used in a lot of different ways in our food and our culture, but here they are in the context of drinks, mm-hmm. sometimes in unusual ways and sometimes in expected ways, mm-hmm. Classics. But there's this other timeline that this hotel follows, and it's 7 of these rituals that they're not undebatable, but they're definitely 7 good solid markers through the calendar year in New Orleans.
Mm-hmm.
Two of them are kind of cousins. One summer dress and one is winter dress.
Right.
You can probably imagine summer dress.
Yes, yes. Can only imagine, right.
Expensive couches. Mm-hmm. You know, in the olden days, the nicer couches sure. got covered for sweaty bodies. But also, you know, maybe you know, these are really kind of more summery than fallish. You know, you put up your whites and your
mm-hmm. right.
Cecil rugs and your, you know, in some way life changes and clothes change to reflect the season.
Mm-hmm.
winter going the other direction, kind of, and the onset of all things fall. A couple of the others are St. John's Day, and I think I'm going to show you the elixir that I made for St. John's
cool.
Day, because it's pretty neat, and it's more than a cocktail. It's like it's a potion, really. All Saints Day.
Right, of course.
And, you know, these are things where, you know, there's something going on in the old Catholic calendar. It's a very Catholic city. But also, more than likely, and like on St. John's Day, it's probably even got more of a meaning in the other religions that are infusing this culture.
Right.
Haitian. Along with voodoo, which is sort of like a Haitian New Orleans mix.
Right.
It's pretty complicated stuff.
Yeah.
I keep needing to do this overlapping study to realize how these things hook together, because it's almost like no writer can treat all of this crossbreeding and cross
pollination. You think it's a very interesting city to really grasp, because there's so many things going on.
And I'm right here, and I'm around it, and I still can't grasp it. Because, because it also seems to be totally about synthesis. Like, the traditions don't stay and be very autonomous. And I'm sure that's true in Brooklyn or whatever, but in Brooklyn I can still see, you know, certain cultures sticking together and really maybe holding on to it. I think here they maybe even, like, they warp into other interesting things even. Well, you know, jazz was that.
Yeah,
happening in music, rock and roll was that happening from blues and country and stuff. And something in the air here, and it's almost like the pot's on simmer already, you know? It's trying to, like, you come here with your bags and stuff, and pretty soon your belongings and yourself are going to be
exactly
going both directions. The tide coming in and out.
I mean, it's 300 years of cultures coming together. That's what I love about this city.
That's right.
300 years.
No place like it.
There's no other place. Whenever we explain to people, when they come to New Orleans for the first time, we say, you know, it's like going to a different country. You're in geographically the United States. However, when you come here, you hear different languages. You see French and Creole and Cajun and Americans. And it's very interesting. And what I find is that they all seem to mesh together in a positive way.
I think largely. I don't think we're really hiding our behind. You know, we have a lot of unfortunate things and poverty.
Sure.
But I don't think it's hidden here. I just think it's a factor of, you know, a lot of not so good things about Southern life. And the city seems to kind of have a coherence in kind of surviving and. Whether, you know, natural catastrophes like
Katrina,
and then going back to yellow fever,
which
wrecked the town yearly for many years in its past. And so there's a certain, like, common kind of survival that goes beyond just maybe there's less time to dislike your neighbor here. I don't know, but there seems to be an awful lot of generosity and sharing. You know, is my honest evaluation. Yeah.
Yeah,
acceptance, I guess.
Yeah.
Acceptance.
Okay,
almost like respect.
All of you, like, got dumped out of somewhere and you landed here. You know, it's like, okay, whatever, just join in and let's make this thing roll. It's a certain laissez-faire, but it's also somehow the culture seems to stay a culture. I mean, whenever I doubt it, it seems like some people come in from somewhere, Canada or whatever, and they're like, no, we promise you, you can tell. Because as a local, half the time you think you're losing the good stuff, and then 10 years ago it was better than now. But I mean, something's still wild and strange and very unusual about this place.
So the thing is always constantly reinventing itself. I mean, you have classic stuff that was invented, as far as, and not just culture, but in cocktails as well, it's always you know, you have those underlying traditions, like in cocktail, like the Sazerac, stuff that was been here, with food, you know, what they've done with food, and Eggs Benedict's and all those stuff, and and then it's always, you have those, and now you, it's always changing, you think it's always reinventing, or building upon those traditions.
Couldn't agree more. And it's been playful to me to arrive at this, you know, cocktail tradition in a sort of just really very free way. And since I grew up an hour away, I felt more like, you know, rather than working under the shadow of a cocktail tradition, I felt more like, no, these are these things that grow all around me, and I've been growing. You know, growing up next to the most fantastic strawberries my whole life.
Right.
I'm just going to use these things and entertain people. And then, of course, with time, I also just found more interest in the stories of these things and, you know, how they've gotten used in different ways.
Do you feel like your purveyors have helped cultivate that within your cocktail program? Learning about them and what they do and how they really give their all to bring the best products to you so that you can use them in whatever you're doing, but it's all integrated. I mean, do you have a favorite purveyor or people that you work with?
Just an example, a very remarkable woman named Isabel, who has a gorgeous citrus orchard across the river, so I think you would call that place where she is, Algiers technically. It's down the road from the little town of Algiers. But when citrus comes out, she has the whole spectrum, and it's quite huge. We don't really, I don't think, dish up enough to send out to a bunch of other cities, but everything grows here, and she's made this incredible orchard. It's organic. She has a lot of character herself, which adds to what she does, and she delivers to a number of restaurants, and you know, we don't have the level of industry in all respects that some other places do. You know, I think Satsumas are a little bit bigger of a deal, and they get those out to some other cities and all that. But compared to Florida or California, you know, things are a little more personal and a delicate balance here. Like some of those strawberry farmers that are really have the beautiful heirloom berries are, you know, competed with by some people that are accepting hybrids that are a little more durable and maybe a little less beautiful, a little less tasty.
Right.
And so, you know, it's just, I'm touched by just seeing the personal nature of everything. You know, going to the farmer's market and just talking to these people who, yes, just love what they do.
Yeah,
and
so passionate.
And you know, they're not driving some expensive vehicle.
No.
Or, you know, it's a real precious connection for the city to have for these people that grow beautiful things, to bring them in. And then, you know, in my own modest way, but definitely in the hands of our chefs, there starts to be some artistry and expression of the place. You know what I mean? Like, not saying that somebody can't make a pie back in my hometown of him and like my mom, and it's beautiful in its own way, but it's interesting to the rest of the world how a piece of fruit or, you know, beautiful strawberry might make it into the hands of a John Besh or something, you know, somebody that's going to transform it.
Sure.
And, you know, I mean, that's...
So you think that's what you're doing with cocktails? Is that you're transforming?
Oh, no question
about
it.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And I know that because I would have lost interest myself if it weren't an activity that sort of kept me interested and alive. You know, it's not me, it's the things I allow to connect when I'm, you know, the more and more the little stories I'm telling that help to anchor the cocktail in some way. Mm-hmm. Just as an example, we have a tradition of doing the Pimm's Cup over at Napoleon House.
Sure.
The whole world knows it.
Sure.
It's really not a New Orleans cocktail. It's just that it got
right
appropriated at some point and it worked.
Right.
And it's so perfect because it's light. It's easy mm-hmm. for bartenders to make. Even the Napoleon House just uses Sprite. They don't mm-hmm. make it all fancy. It's just
right.
It's just good. So this is like a powerful, in some ways maybe complex, a little more gourmet mm-hmm. thing, Pimm's thing, but I couldn't not acknowledge where it came from. When France ceremoniously presented New Orleans her splendid golden statue, we did what we do with all our things we want to protect for posterity. We put it in a storage unit. True story,
I love
actually.
That.
And I think about, I don't know how long it's sat in there, like 20 years. Anyway,
they
took it out finally, but Napoleon Bonaparte, whose namesake bar down the street captured the Pimm's Cup from Britain, declared this teenage warrior a national symbol. She now lives blocks away from here on Decatur Street, the
right.
statue.
Mm-hmm.
And caught in political crossfire, nearly suffered another martyrdom last year when she was tagged, tear it down. Who knows why poor Joan and some
right.
was up.
She had
on a platform.
She had a rough go of it.
Guys.
At the end. She had a rough go at the end.
So what I see is that you've encapsulated you were a director, or you've got your degree in directing, mm-hmm. and the artistic and the spiritual and the respect for the culture all together. So how do you have a guest come in, how do you convey that to a guest that has... maybe he's from the Midwest, has no idea, mm-hmm. like, what the heck's going on here?
Well, you never think you're doing quite good enough a job. In fact,
right.
I just had a good talk with Sean, and even though I have jars and jars of things marinating, macerating,
right.
and all of that, and I do on the bar sometimes, he pulled out a magazine where a guy had them all, more visible in his bar, and he said, Alan, maybe we should... is just a little more clear, because some of your people don't realize that you took something and made a syrup that you had to mother over the syrup for
right.
several hours, and then but you hope it's like this three-way thing or three or four-way thing. You hope it's a little bit of the menu.
Right.
You hope it's a lot the person serving it. I mean, when I'm back there, I mean, it's on me to kind of draw people in and be like, hey, get
so
excited.
You're a storyteller.
Well, the thing is, they're usually excited, right?
Right.
New
sure.
Orleans, we're in, but
right.
then they're confused.
Right.
They're like, yeah, last night we went on Bourbon Street. We're not sure whether we liked it or not. And I'm like, well, that's because that wasn't really what we've got to offer you.
No, this is a whole different level of what you're doing here.
Well, not just here, but starting
yeah.
to
yeah,
tell them,
yeah.
you need to go
story,
to
right.
this restaurant, you need
right.
to go to
here,
this, and
right.
this, and this, and it's not, it's not following neon signs around.
Exactly.
This place.
Exactly.
In fact, it's kind of a little bit hard to find. The more time goes by and the more t-shirt shops and daiquiri shops spring up, find the older city.
You raise an interesting thing, because we hear, we're based in Las Vegas. There's mixologists that are world renowned in Las Vegas.
Yes.
So I always have this term, mixologists and bartenders. And I want to hear, are they the same to you, or are they different? How would you describe them?
I think mixologist is a word that makes you blush in a way, because it just sounds like it's up there in the
right.
the realms of science somehow. And all it means is, I think, the public and journalism kind of acknowledging that those people have a pretty strong, somewhere between amateur and professional, taste or interest in things, and then every bartender these days kind of knows that they need to also be a good bartender and not forget that part of it, because
right.
What they're really there to do is host.
You're a bartender first.
They're supposed to be a
absolutely.
Host.
Absolutely,
yeah.
You're a host.
And you're not supposed to be an instructor.
Right.
You're not there to
right.
talk about Campari for 30 minutes, unless
exactly.
they're bored.
Right.
You can do that. Otherwise, you're there to make their little
and have a
date
good time.
Or their thing go better.
Right.
Stay in the, like a good host, stay so you available, think but friendly and out of the way.
I think a good analogy would be the one I like to use, and please correct me if I'm wrong. I like that when I'm telling people about bartenders and mixologists, is that mixologists are more like a chef. Mm-hmm. Is that you create from, like you do, you purvey all these flavors and these strawberries and stuff from different areas, and you're the creator, and a bartender more or less takes the menu and serves it.
That's correct.
Okay, good.
That's correct, okay. And like so many overlaps, teachers are often really writers, but they don't get to write full-time. They teach, right. So they can write during the summer, mm-hmm. and a lot of bartenders have some degree of the mixologist in them.
Sure.
And, because there's a couple of guys here that they're not going to make up a drink in their free time, and then I'm the kind of guy that kind of wants to go try a new combination and get on to this next thing. And that's just whatever floats your boat.
So do you allow them to have playtime, let them create or present stuff to you?
Of course.
Yeah.
Oh, of course.
Cool. Awesome.
But some people, there's not pressure to do that because it's like the job doesn't, in some ways, my position does afford me the freedom to spend time on that. But generally, as a bartender, you're paid for these duties that none of them quite say, we're paid for your brilliance to come up with the next combination. Most of the brilliance comes out the side of the mouth, when they're playing right before the shift.
Internal drive to create this. I want to show you something. Yeah.
Yeah, you could probably tell that, right? It's not like this person was in a lab for the afternoon. They're probably trying something. In fact, you might even be the inspiration. They might want to try a little trick in front of you,
that.
And that's part of the fun, I guess.
Or they'll ask a question. Like for me, they say, here's the menu, put aside. What do you like to drink?
Yes.
Do you like white spirits? You like dark spirits? You like vodka? You like gin? And they start narrowing it down, like six questions. Next thing you have an Elaine drink or a Scott drink that's never been created before.
Right. How many classics go back to some story of like this guy was saying I like scotch and I was in a fix but I had these berries. Adam, you okay? Okay.
That's cool.
I totally agree.
Look at
the way you put it. But certainly, you probably would expect to taste something, and that's
absolutely.
I would make
why we're here.
What I'll do is I'll show you something from one of those, in some ways maybe the most impressive cocktail that goes with one of the rituals I spoke of.
Okay.
And then why not just taste you on a couple of the kinds of cocktails I do? There's one that's real
let's,
fun.
Let's do it. It's been so much fun to hang out.
I do want to ask you though, do you have certain people or a couple people that have been your mentors or have inspired you to keep up and encourage you along the way as far as your integration with the spiritual and the respect for the land and the ingredients? Do you have people that have helped you to cultivate your love and interest in all this, putting it together? Can you name a few people that you'd like to?
I mean, especially the guy I work for. Because, I mean, if I were working for just some unnamed hotel chain and I began talking about the spiritual aspect of cocktails, I mean, they might be polite, but I don't think they'd want to hear a lot of it.
Yeah.
He really encourages that. I mean, the point of that he would say, we need to put more of this out there. As a city, this is maybe what we have to offer, is reminding people of that underlying spiritual aspect of things. And it doesn't have to mean totally sacred. It can just mean the level of intention that you do things. Things that have, there's voodoo again.
Yeah, that's what
intentions
say,
behind
intention
things.
Energy,
very well put.
And kind of what you're doing.
I don't think anybody would be be upset by that conversation, but I don't see enough time given to it in the food magazines, or, you know, we're just not, culturally, we don't have a lot of time to go around talking about that stuff.
That's, but it's so true, but I think it is needful, and I think it is actually there, just people aren't seeing it.
Absolutely. And, like, if the pendulum were to swing a little more in some way.
Yeah, I met a winemaker in the Willamette Valley, and he had a whole spiritual philosophy on his winemaking. It was biodynamic. Yeah. He was from, his culture was Persian, and it was just so fascinating to me. Like, and I thought, well, this is what it means. You know, you have that connection between your energy, your spirit, and the land, Mother Earth, and you're trying to make all these connections so that you're bringing this product, which is really a reflection of all of this. And if you have that connection, I think you bring a better product and you bring your best to that because you have the right intention to it.
And then flavor stops being this just game of, you know, what's weirder and more.
And then that, like, your drink or your food, it becomes part of you because you're assimilating that too. So then now it's becoming part of you. And then you get that interconnection.
That's so right. And,
you know?
And
sometimes
sometimes that knowledge really does create the reality. In other words, if someone has something to drink or eat and has a little bit of that feeling of how important it is to share, you know, or whatever, while they're doing it, they change probably a little more than the person that's just nabbing a bite, right?
Yeah.
Nabbing a hamburger.
And I think that, like, Europeans are more in tune with that concept as far as their eating.
Sacredness of eating.
Yeah.
Right.
As opposed to our culture here in the United States. But that, I think that is why New Orleans is so unique, because it is one of our most European cities, and it has that foundation, and it has hundreds of years of cooking and cultivating and bringing these great flavors, and they keep doing it, and they keep at it, and it hasn't gone it.
So maybe it's about having enough layers that you go down and find the nerve.
I think
a nurse looks for the vein with the...
There you go.
You know,
you're right.
Like, you know, they're as amazing as California winemaking is. Sometimes they have a little trouble deciding, like, do we have terroir or do we not?
Right, you know, exactly.
Like,
you're right.
Or should we just emphasize ingenuity and, you know, grapefruit?
Yeah, you're always butting up against commercialism and all that.
And that too.
But thank you.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
Thank you. Yeah, it's been an honor, and now we get to really have another honor to get to taste some of your beautiful creation.
Yeah, I hope you didn't mind waiting. You know,
oh, no, not at all. Well,
thank
let's,
you so much for
let's
your time,
do it.
Really
we will see you
at, making myself for you.
We'll see you at your home ground at the bar.